Series, and I also want to apologize ahead of time if you hear any construction going outside. My father is currently rebuilding our deck, so a lot of like new changes, renovations, just rebuilding, rediscovering, rebirth have been happening in these past few months, and really just this past year alone. And what I kind of found with That Way Bad Time, though it's a series I do love, I find that I don't want to
use up or waste a spiritual bath just for the sake of it. And I'm starting to find my groove with a lot of things, such as like with my own business, with Harold Henrietta, with spirituality in general. So I also like to announce, for those who don't know, that I have revived my Format Adolescent content series on my own terms. It is on Spotify. It is my podcast, Tea Your Time with Tisha Mae. And this time with it, I actually go more in depth about certain tarot cards that have been speaking to me, and which I feel like are sort of that speak a lot to the collective. I'm very excited because I feel like that was something very much more personal, very much more aligned to what I've been wanting to do, or I finally like figured out exactly what it is that I want to like execute with it. Or what I want to talk about, because it's tea world time, we're sharing the tea, we're talking about tarot. I'm giving guys tea on my life, but I'm also like letting you guys know, like, this may resonate with you guys. This is how I sometimes handle situations, or sometimes the situations are in a minute still figuring themselves out. But I feel like the series has definitely come around to not feel so, I guess, draining or consuming or time consuming or really just energetically consuming, to where it just feels a lot more aligned to what I want to talk about, what I want to go in depth to in regards to tarot as well. It's kind of educational, but it's very much like lifestyle, because I am sharing like stuff that has gone on in my own life. I'm still doing the thing where I just, you know, tell you guys things that you guys may relate to. And I really, really do enjoy it, and I cannot wait. And the first episode is out, which is basically kind of like a reintroduction of the series, but also like a reintroduction of me like trying to like get back into YouTube, because I don't want to be just like some freaking YouTube tarot lady, even though that's sometimes what I describe myself as, or that I literally log line or outro myself out as. That's kind of what I am, but my Aquarius tendency is like, no, we don't follow trends. What that means for Beltway Bath Time, I figure that
because it is a series that I do love to do, but I don't want it to take away and take space of like my spiritual readings.
Beltway Bath Time, I believe for now, is going to be basically like a biannual series. That being said and all, I am super excited for really finding alignment in the things that I want to do and that I need to do. It's It's been a very eventful, I can say somewhat challenging year, but it's been a year of growth for sure. And granted, I've always said and stated that I am not meant to stay on one path. Literally, the paths I've gone through this year have been paths that I can't be mad at Spirit for being like, this is what you wanted, this is what you asked for. And you're absolutely right. So without further ado, go ahead and like and subscribe and comment down below if you enjoyed today's episode, and look at the description to see all my links to my social media, especially to the link of my podcast, Hero Time with T-Shane May. And now, without further ado, let's go ahead to today's topic for this episode of Beltway Bath Time, a Tub Talk series by your girl, T-Shane May, aka Henrietta. Let's get it.
The topic that I want to talk about today, and this has been a topic that's been in my life for quite some long time, ever since I had to do this, was I wanted to talk about twin flames.
And because of the fact that I, you know, previously spoke about my twin flames and the other Beltway Bath Time episodes, I basically wanted to go more in depth about twin flames, about like how twin flames have become mainstream, what my experience with my twin flame is, and hence why I am no longer in communication with them right now and have not been since the beginning of this year.
What are twin flames? Twin flames are like the soulmates of soulmates. They're literally the description of like your other half.
Your other half that mirrors you, your other half that, you know, there is a folktale myth where we were born with like four arms and four legs, and then we got separated all through people's lives. People go search your lives to find their like other half or their soulmate, and a step up from that is twin flames.
Now let's talk about soulmates. Soulmates, yes, are people whose souls that are much aligned with yours, whether it be a past life soul energy. There's also karmic soul ties, soulmates that I've talked about before, which they are your soulmates, but it's for you guys to like learn a lesson. It's where you guys learn a lesson through each other and then go about learning that lesson either together or like on your own, depending on if it is destined and designed for you to like come back together. And twin flames are that, but on crack.
They are absolutely that, but literally on crack. I had a former spiritual mentor. She told me out the blue, I was gonna meet a boy. He was gonna be this, that, and a third. And I was like, okay. And then a couple weeks later, that came out to be true. Mind you, I was not looking for it. It was just kind of like, okay. But I get what she was saying, because sometimes when you get a message and you have to say it, you have to say it. So I get where she was coming from. Or when I figured it out that it was this person, I was like, oh, holy shit, you were right. Holy shit, you were absolutely correct. You know, our relationship was an entanglement. To say that to the very least. In short, the long and the short is that our relationship was an entanglement. It was a situationship. I did not develop feelings for that person until, mind you, after, but I was finding myself to be emotionally drawn and concerned for this person. Mind you, the first few times with that person, it felt like home. It felt like home, it felt safe, and it felt wonderful. I believe it was something like having been a hopeless romantic, now being a hopeful romantic, was something that I was searching for in my life. But over time, and I was saying, but even before our period of separation, and to go about the period of separation, especially twin flames usually go through a big period or series of period of separations where you guys just don't talk to each other because you guys are kind of just handling your own shit and getting shit done before you guys come back together in union. The thing about that, and after our period of separation and even a bit beforehand, was that I was stripping layers and parts of myself from this person because I was appealing to or trying to appeal to an image that this person desired.
I think this person made it very clear about what his type is or what type of woman he's attracted to. And it led to quite a few things that I just do the math. I had to go get a yoni steam and then do a sitz bath for.
Because I had trauma, I had regrets, I had resentments that were living in me that I had to like, oh, I can't have this shit inside me no more, right? Fast forward to last summer, I realized at a friend's mom's wedding that I needed to let this person go. Mainly because she said that with her now husband that they went through a breakup because for whatever reasons. And it is that quote of, you know, if you let someone go and they come back, it's meant to be. And I do believe that. I do believe that. Granted, we are humans. Granted, we are all trying to get through life. Granted, we are all trying the fucking best we can. But I definitely agree with that. And I knew right then and there at that wedding, because I bawled my eyes out when her mom walked down the aisle. I did not know what overcame of me at that time. But I knew that there was love in the air and I wanted something like it. So I decided to let that person go. Mind you, yes, that person came back, but here's the thing, the person kind of only came back when they had something they needed. They needed help, they wanted answers, they needed some type of reassurance, not to check in, not to send memes or, you know, like, and I just had a discussion with like one of my bewitches last night where you can't just try to come back into my life after you said you needed space. Or we can't just do one all big check-in if there weren't any check-ins in between. There's certain people, yes, I can do that with, but that's because there isn't, not even an exception. There's an expectation that they have already met to where it's totally fine if that's what we do. I practically, like, with people who are, like, in my top five tier of, like, friends, I do those big check-ins with them, either through the phone or through social media or literally, like, actually hanging out. And the thing is, like, we've been friends long enough to, like, know that this is how we are.
So there is a patience, there is an understanding. If you apologize to me once, you ain't gotta apologize again. So if you apologize to me again, and then I'll be like, okay, this is your last time apologizing. Thank you, I got you. Don't apologize anymore, right?
I feel like it was just not that with that person. And it also got to the point where I couldn't really tell them things going on in my life because I didn't really think they would be that excited for it. There was always some type of over-analytical, over-intellectualizing coming from an Aquarius. There was a lot of over-intellectualizing coming from that person, and sometimes like, bitch, I just want to enjoy shit. I just want to, can I just enjoy something? Like, it doesn't have to be a theory or discourse or discussion. There was just a lot of judgment and condescension, and especially with the friends that person has that I used to be friends with, it's just kind of like that energy just seeped all the way through. And I'm here like, has this person always been like this? Or is this person only acting like this because so-and-so is like that? So I kind of fuck with that, truly. My thing is that literally I had to let this person go. And mind you, last time I saw that person was Halloween, last year. I will say this, I haven't talked to that person since like right after Estada, right after like spring has started. Literally, when spring started, I had deleted everything about that person off my phone. I deleted their number, my friend deleted the group chat of us, and hey person, if you're watching, I hope you're doing well, I hope you healed. And it got to the point where I even asked my mom about this person. And then I had to tell my mom, like, and mind you, I talked about my therapist for, like, me and my therapist talked about this for, like, the past, like, this has been something that me and my therapist probably worked on for probably about a good 6 months. Because that's how long it took to, like, heal from it. because I had to like realize like I regret something with this person that caused me trauma, and I had resentment towards them. I had to go through the whole nine yards to heal. Now I'm in a place of forgiving this person, but it's not my duty. It's not my job, because I've been the one also initiating things for the most part. Like when I say this period of separations happened, I could tell when it was being led by me or him. And most of the time it was being led by him.
So that being said, it was just kind of like, you don't really hit me up. You don't really be thorough on your check-ins. You only come forward when you need something. And it's like, don't you have other people that can answer those questions for you?
So my whole thing is just kind of like, I became a convenience. And mind you, talking to like my bitch yesterday, I was just like, and my therapist and my best friend Michael, what's up, dog? Like, I was just like, I'm not trying to be a convenience for anybody. I don't want to be a convenience for anybody. So why am I presented as or seen as such? Why is that? I didn't ask for that. So why am I treated as such? And that became me having to lessen my expectations from that person and other friends.
I cannot expect this person to show up for me unless I have to directly tell them, which is a lot of work and makes me feel like I'm not really of importance to your life, or you don't really value me because you don't really actively show effort, or the effort has not been shown to me or proven to me that you have met my expectations, that you show up for me even if I don't have to ask you or beg you to. And that literally, it's just like, when it has nothing to do with you.
Or that we don't happen to conveniently be working together. Mind you, a lot of those friends I cut off, or some of them, including him, we are in the same industry. We work in the same industry. So if I see you, I'm going to be cordial in the workspace environments, because, you know, why bring our personal shit into this professional environment? There's the difference between business and pleasure. Hello. So it's just like, I'm not going to just like ask you in between takes, like, how you been since I cut you off? Like, why would I do that? Especially because this person is the reason why I fucking created boundaries.
I used to not be a person that had boundaries. I used to just be open for anything. But then this person proves like, oh no, bitch, you need to start making boundaries now.
Now is the time to do boundaries. We can't just do this shit. When my best friend Crystal had to come to terms, because granted, I had to say it to her while we were going through this shit together, because we mirror each other. That's my sister. That's my sister sign. She's a Leo. So when me and baby girl Crystal like had to like come to terms, because I had to tell her and be the one to tell her, not all twin flames come together in union, and I'm afraid it's gonna happen to you and this person. I fear that's what you and this person are. I had to come to terms with that myself, because I have to realize, as the hopeless romantic I am, as somebody who read Wet Past stories growing up, who is into fan fiction, I cannot come to terms with this person if this person cannot meet me halfway.
I cannot come to terms with this person if this person cannot meet me where I'm at. I cannot come to terms with this person or come into union with this person if I have to halt or pause my own progress, pause my path for this person to pace and catch up.
And apparently this person used to tell me all the time that I was making strides in my career, which I do say because I was inspired by that person, but it came with such a enviness, because this person was never satisfied. This person was never satisfied. Like, I'm talking like Alexander Hamilton never satisfied. I'm literally Angelica Schuyler. Angelica, Eliza and Peggy.
I wouldn't say entirely, but for those of you who may be watching, especially if you're a spiritualist like me, you may be like, no, girl, that boy was low-key jealous. That boy was low-key, I wouldn't say resentful. I'm not getting resentful. That boy was not willing to put in the work that it took to get to the top, that it took to climb to get to the top. You were not willing to do the climb. You missed the whole mark with Miley Cyrus's decline. Like, you could not climb every mountain, Sound of Music. So it's just kind of like you talk about the MH drives, but you over here like expecting someone to pick you up and literally carry you through the entire thing. It's not always gonna be like that in our industry. That's not what life is. So the fact that you were so like preoccupied and like worried about me, but you just have not done, and like you feel like you have not done enough for yourself, but your credits say otherwise. I don't know how to help you, because I feel like I've been literally on a loop repeating myself like a fucking gif every time I have to tell you something, every time I try to reassure you. Thank you, Father. Like, that shit hit, didn't it? So I kind of had to realize that I could not deal with that. And I also find out that like sometimes when I do cut people off in my life intentionally, as some people still have close ties with them and I know damn well they're not good for them, it's just like, hey, like I just, my tolerance just lessened as well. I don't have a tolerance. I'm not gonna tolerate you putting yourself through this bullshit. I'm not gonna tolerate you not wanting better for yourself, but not doing anything about it. Here's the thing, I am a hyper independent Aquarius, right? Right. I'm gonna be someone who's gonna figure shit out myself. And I have to get to the point to stop being stubborn and not be afraid to ask for help. My thing is really with this person, with this connection, and having to let it go was that I have to realize my worth. I have to understand that I do deserve better. I have to kind of like listen to my friends. I have to, like the friends especially that I went to advise to, I have to kind of like understand, like they see things that I may not be seeing. Because am I blinded by love? Is love blind? Is love blinding? It can be. Fatuation can be. And I think even so, it gets to the point of like, can I truly love someone and their flaws? Can I forgive someone and the trauma they have caused me? Can I put myself through that? I have to come to terms that it's like, I've been through that shit for like a long time in my life with a lot of people. And those a lot of people are no longer in my life for said reason. So that being said, I have to like realize, it's like, yeah, no, I deserve better. I don't need this. I don't want this. And like I said earlier, hey person, if you're watching, I hope you're well, but I hope you healed or are healing. And I hope those sound effects in the background really hits you in the fucking head like a fucking fan. Okay? Now, has this person tried to communicate to me when they kind of like felt the shift in the connection energy? Yes. I did a cord cutting ceremony and this person hit me up right after it, like at the end. Like I'm talking the candle wax burnt out, shit was done. Did I respond back? No. Because I was going to take a spiritual bath because I felt like, oh, I needed one that day. That bath pretty much kind of like insinuate that this was going to be a topic that I was going to talk about in another BB episode. But also, I was getting ready for a work trip that was going to take me across the country. And I was just not emotionally and mentally in the space to deal with that or respond to that. There is a choice to respond. A no response is a response. And here's the thing. Because the person didn't pester, because the person didn't fight, because the person didn't put any more effort, and because I also did intentionally put on read receipts to that person's message thread so they knew that when I saw it and knew when I did not respond, because that person kind of took a hit, I never heard from that person again. I did not respond to that person. Now, there is a letter waiting for you or that person that, you know, pretty much explains everything that I just said and goes more into detail about the reason why I had to end the connection. I let this person go last summer and it took springtime for the connection to end. That's like 9 months right there. Like 3/4 of a year to get over your ass, bitch. I mean, and hey, healing takes time. And I'm not ashamed of that. Even now with potential lovers coming up, I have to be like, bro, like I am a bit burnt out of love and I don't want to project what I went through with this person to this next person coming in. I'm dating me. I'm embracing myself. I'm getting to know myself because I literally had stripped parts of myself back from this person over time. Because I tried to be something this person desired and wanted me to be, but was saying no pressure. But it's like your actions are speaking directly opposite of your words. So the communication is not communicating. You're not being thorough here. You're not being honest. And what's worse is like you're not being honest with me. You're being honest of what you want of me, but you honestly can't handle the actual me. And it took a long time to understand that. I am constantly, and I've always been, ascending and evolving because of it. I'm not stunting my own growth or halting my path just for you to catch up. You gotta put in the work to do that yourself. And I say that just about anyone. Whether you have a twin flame, whether if you have a soulmate, or whether your partner is your soulmate, even with your fucking friends. You gotta put in the effort in a relationship, otherwise there's no relationship at all. It's barely a companionship. Y'all are just acquaintances. Y'all just conveniently work together or happen to stumble upon each other, but y'all don't really, really, really do the effort, do the work to get to know each other, to collab with each other, to create a beautiful connection that can last a long time and lifetimes. And it's true, not all twin flames come into union. That's not to say not every twin flame doesn't come into union, but that's to say that this is my story of how mine didn't. And for those who have previously watched But With Bad Time episodes, y'all saw how I was at that time. How elated, ecstatic, excited I was. Especially when the synchronicities showed themselves. But here's the thing, when I let go of that person last summer, I told Spirit, if he's supposed to come back to me, make him return. And then I got to the point where I had to be like, I'm not asking Spirit's for help. I'm not asking Spirit's help for this. This person will start coming back on their own. Now, if he goes to my spirits or goes to his spirits to get in contact with my spirit, that's fine. That's fine because that at least shows that you're putting in the work. That's a given. That's my ultimatum right there. Because of the fact that it's just like, you really did not come back unless you needed something. Now, the message that you sent was like, hey, are you good? Like, are you mad at me? Hey. I think at that time I was no longer mad at you. I think at that time I was pretty much getting over you. There was nothing to be mad about because I'd done all the things I needed to. I'd done my 12-step like twin flame healing program to practically to the point where I had to literally cut our cords of attachment to remove you from my life. Now, once again, same industry, same state or whatever, listen, I'll see you when I see you, but I'm not going to give you an answer unless you ask for it. And just like how you said, person, how you always said, well, you didn't ask. Well, you did ask, but I chose not to answer. You did ask, but you didn't follow up on your question. I don't know if that could see me because of the silhouette, but... Thank you guys again so much for being a part of me and being with me in this episode of But Wait That Time. Like I said, this series may be something bi-annually. I don't know when the next episode is going to come out, but do stay tuned for it. I may get to a point where I will try to blast all the other episodes previously, things I talked about on my social media accounts, so people can get more engaged with it. Feel free to like, subscribe, share, comment down below. Tell me if you had a twin flame and you had to, you know, let them go, or you had your fair share of like soulmates, karmic soulmates. And follow me on all my social media, especially on Hero Henrietta on Instagram, and also follow me and subscribe to my podcast on Spotify, Tea Row Time with T. Shay May. And I literally wish you guys peace, love, strength, creativity. I will see you guys next time on Dragon Ball Spirituality.